means that the person who makes the most noise, like a wheel, a noisy wheel is making a lot of noise, is going to get attention, okay? So the person who's going to make some noise, who's going to stand up and speak up and protest and let people know that they exist, they're going to get attention, okay? And that's what I mean by the squeaky wheel gets the grease.
It was a Saturday afternoon, and like typical Florida days, it was pouring out. And my daughters were 8 and 5 at the time, and they were clamoring to go into the pool. And I said, look, in Florida it rains, within a half an hour, it'll stop, you'll be in the pool. So sure enough, half an hour later, we're the first family at the pool. About a half an hour later, we're joined by 75 others, all of whom were black. And as it turns out, we're in the middle of a wonderful African-American family reunion. I learned that over 200 people from across the country came to the same hotel this weekend to have a great family get-together. So a little time goes by, and my 8-year-old daughter, who grew up in Stoneham, Rachel, comes up to me and says, Dad, I don't feel comfortable. I want to go back to the room. And I said, okay. So I took her inside, and I sat down, and I said, Rachel, let me ask you a question. Are you uncomfortable because everyone here is black? And I knew her response. A shrug of the shoulders and didn't say anything. And I said, honey, that's okay. I said, you've never been in this situation before, but I want you to think about Christian and Chloe, two black kids at your school. That's their world every day. I said, you know that God created everyone equally. It doesn't matter what skin color you are, what religion you are, we're all the same. But more importantly, I want you to think about this family, how they're coming together for a family reunion. The people my age are meeting cousins they haven't seen in years, and people your age are meeting cousins that they probably are meeting for the very first time. So let's just go back and have a good time. Well, Rachel jumps into the pool, and 3 hours later, I'm dragging her out of it, kicking and screaming. And basically, she became part of the family that day. And while that was going on, I befriended this little boy who kind of reminded me of myself and probably some of you. He was a skinny little kid, and he was working his way around the pool, and several times he'd let go and went under, and I would reach down and I would grab him, and we really made this really strong connection. And as fate would have it, both of our families leave the pool at the same time. We get in the same elevator and get off at the same floor. So as we part ways, I hear this little voice yelling down the hall to me, and he says, hey, I'll see you by the pool tomorrow. But we were leaving in the morning, so I said, oh, I'm sorry, but you know, we're not going to be here. He put up his little hand and waved and said, bye, friend. I did the same. When chills literally ran up and down my spine, it was amazing. So that night, while I'm in bed, I'm almost on the verge of tears. I'm thinking about that incredible exchange with that little boy, but I'm thinking as a parent, the incredible lesson that my daughter learned. That's something she probably would never learn in Boston. And you know, I look back and I explain the story as, you know, the footsteps left behind that day were beautiful ones of black and white.
This up a little bit. I'm going to go through four different things. First is a little background, tell you who I am. We're all meeting each other today, this morning, right? So I'll tell you a little bit who I am, where I came from, and a little bit what I do. And then I want you to kind of hold on to that, because I want to save at least 10 minutes at the end for people to ask questions about that, because I think that that could be very helpful for kids thinking about what they want to do. And then I want to touch on some of the things that I hear that's really important to the program, and talking a little bit about investing in, you know, resources, people, time, how to manage money, and how to also, you know, really thinking about investing in yourself as well. And I think that all those things are lessons I learned, and it took me a long time to kind of put all that together and to have it be useful. So that's the way I'd like to structure it, and hopefully, and I want this to be a little bit interactive, so I'm going to move around a little bit, look at folks, and it's okay to interrupt me and ask questions. Fair enough? All right. So first, let me tell you a little bit about me. So I grew up in Springfield, Mass., just down the road, down the pike a little bit, and you know, I found this out later on when I was 17, but I was actually one of the first kids who was in Head Start. It wasn't Head Start then, it was called like, whatever the program was. It had a name, right? It had a little program, but I was, because my mother was born, a single mom, and she wasn't working. And, you know, when I was young, she put me into Head Start program. And then later on, when she was able, she married my stepfather, he actually taught me a lot of things. And that allowed us to do a lot of different things later on. But that's where I was born in Springfield. My mother's from Conway, South Carolina. My dad, my stepdad, was from Carrollton, Alabama. So he had nine brothers and sisters. He never really finished school. He dropped out of school in seventh grade and just worked. That was his whole thing. He just worked, worked, worked the whole time. He actually found out later on when I was in high school, he was functionally illiterate. He actually couldn't read. I didn't know that because what he would do when he was working on the cars, he would say, all right, yeah, I don't know, you guys don't know this, but you know, they used to have these big auto books, like the children's auto books, right?
Oh, yeah.
Parents know what I'm talking about. So now you just go online and check it out, but then you'd have to open up, he'd just say, open up the book, son, and he'd be under the car, like this. And he'd say, read me the paragraph. And I'd say, okay, you gotta do this with the alternator. And I thought he was just doing that because his eyes were bad. But I didn't realize for a long time that actually he just couldn't read. So these are things that I figured out later on. And when I grew up in Springfield, Springfield actually was not a bad place to be. Oh, sorry, I got to be in the middle. I can't move too far from the camera. Sorry about that. Springfield was, there's a lot of jobs. There's a lot of job opportunities for folks. But we, you know, we grew up, you know, in one of the projects there. We moved over into apartments later on. And then, you know, after that, I was in public schools. And I was really lucky in that my mother spent a lot of time and spent a lot of effort telling me that I could do whatever I wanted to do. And I don't think I believed her when I was young. And it was very difficult, I think, for me at the time. There was a lot of pressure, as a lot of you know, to not do well in school. I'm not going to sit here and tell you that I was, you know, valedictorian in my class. I was not. I was a very good student. I chose difficult classes. I was surrounded by people who really wanted more. And I kept saying, well, let me figure out how they did that so I could try to figure that out. But I went off to college. And I had to work my way through college, you know, and I had a lot of debt when I came out of college because nobody was able to pay for it. And when I was in college, I wasn't thinking about medicine. I was not thinking about medicine at all. I was actually just thinking about getting a college degree in science. I was a biochemistry major, and getting a job and paying off some of these bills. And that's when people started coming up to me and saying, Chris, do you think maybe you want to do this? Maybe you want to go to school a little bit longer and be a scientist. And I said, okay, let me check that out. I tried that for a little while, and I got a master's degree. Found that wasn't for me. Working in a lab was great, but then I wanted something else. So I came and worked in Boston for a few years, and again, somebody came up to me and said, Chris, you ever think about going into medicine? At that time, I said, you must be crazy, because I didn't know any physicians. I just spent 6 years, you know, after high school in school, I was broke, and I needed to pay some bills, and I didn't really understand how all that would work. But the seed of that, the person talked to me, and they kept coming back to me, and they kept pushing me about this. And finally, when after I worked for a couple of years, I was able to see how that could happen. I worked with some physicians, and I saw that you could be a doctor and, you know, do research, and that this was something that I could attain as well. So I was able to study for the tests and go back to school, and I went to Tufts Medical School, and I became a physician. And then I was trained at Boston Medical Center just down the road, and that's when the first time when all the things that were important to me came together. Where I'm from, you know, having come from a background that's very familiar, a working background, you know, with parents who had to struggle, that was really important because suddenly I'm interacting with patients who, when they have to take a day off from work, don't get paid. And my colleagues don't understand that because they came from a very different background. They don't understand that when people, they don't go see the doctor sometimes because if they don't go to work, they don't get paid that day. So you don't go to the doctor unless you're really, really sick. And those things I knew intuitively. I also knew when a patient once told me, I can't stay to have my heart worked on, the person that had a heart attack, because I got to go home and pay some bills. And the other residents were like, this person doesn't care about his health. I said, no, that's not the issue. The issue is he's got to go somewhere and wire some money to somebody, or something is not going to happen, something to get turned off, or something else is going to happen. And that's why he's willing to sacrifice his health. It is not that he's being selfish. And if we can say, okay, maybe we can talk to somebody, or can I write you a letter, then he'll stay for the procedure. And of course, that's what it was, because intuitively, I knew where he was coming from. I had experienced those things. So it was very helpful to me when I was training as a physician. And then after that, I was very blessed. I was very lucky to go and do, I got very interested in oncology or cancer. And I also haven't forgotten what we call the difference between folks who have means education that allows them to be able to access great care. They're able to take care of themselves, go to the better, you know, the hospitals that will do the most aggressive treatments. Whereas folks, if you speak a different language, if you come from a different country, if you're a man or woman of color, the care that you're getting is not always at the same quality. Not because the provider's not as good, but because of the way the system is set up. And that became what I wanted to focus my research on, what we call disparities in care by race and class. Because, you know, race is a major issue, but as you heard today too, you know, kind of the structure, you know, I always say broke people everywhere have troubles. And there's different troubles and there's different things that keep you from attaining the things you want to go to. So that's really the research I do. So now I take care of lung cancer patients. I see patients who have lung cancer and I give them chemotherapy. And that's the focus of what I do. I also do research where I try to show where it is that patients of color in particular, but poor patients in general, are not getting the same kind of cancer treatment, and then try to figure out ways to fix that.